Okay, so here's a big statement. This 12400 is the best 6-core CPU that we have in the world at the moment, especially at this price point. It trades blows with some of the processors that are double or three times its price. I was very, very impressed, and I hope you were as well. So, shall we have a look at this then? Let's go.
Licensing Windows has never been easier and cheaper. Go to whokeys.com, search for Windows 10 Pro license, or click on the link in the video description below. Purchase the license and use the code TN20 to get a 20% discount. Paste the key into the activation settings and you're all done. By the way, this license also works for Windows 11 when upgraded from licensed Windows 10. Check out whokeys.com in the video description below.
So some of the specs of the CPU that actually mattered. So it is a 6-core and 12-thread CPU. It also has an iGPU, which is the UHD 730, which is a cut-down version of the 770 that you can see, like the i5, i7, i9K versions of the 12th-gen chips. One of the main downsides for this iGPU for creators is that it only has one media engine. The TDP is 65 watts, but the boost TDP can be up to 110 watts, somewhere around there. It's a non-overclockable CPU, which kind of isn't true because you can actually in some cases overclock the CPU. It supports up to 128 gigabytes of RAM, whether it's DDR4 or DDR5, and the price range for this is roughly around $200 to $210 US, or around 190 to 195 pounds here in the UK. In order to test this, we need to set up a test bench. So our test bench, we're basically using the Z690 Pro I'd build that we did on the channel. Feel free to check that out. But the main components are the ASUS Z690 Pro I'd motherboard, this 12400F. For cooling, we're using the Absolute Overkill Fantex Glacier 1 360mm AIO with 6 fans in push and pull configuration. We're using 4 16GB of DDR5 sticks running at 4800 megahertz. For graphics, we're using the ASUS TUF RTX 1390. The OS drive is the Cardia C440, and the project drive where all the benchmarks are on are the Seagate FireCuda 530 drive. We're also using a 1200 watt ROG Thor power supply for this build because why not? In terms of temperatures, power consumption, and cooling for this CPU, it's running very, very cool. Now, at 100% utilization, as you can see on this Cinebench R23 multi-core test, we're seeing around 85 watts pulled maximum from the socket, which is very, very good. It runs very, very cool. Basically, any potato cooler you can put on this will do very, very good. Even the included cooler inside the box is quite all right with this. My only concern with this is it's a little bit loud and lets the CPU run around 85C at 100% utilization. So when it's also inside the case, I'd highly recommend an upgrade to the included cooler, because it's not just going to be running cooler, it's also going to be running much more silent. As always, this channel is focused on the creators, so you're not going to see any gaming benchmarks over here. Feel free to check out other reviews on YouTube, but we're going to start with Cinebench R23. You're going to see different systems here on the screen, and feel free to pause this at any point, but I'm going to focus in the most interesting comparisons for that specific benchmarks. In the single core test, you can see that we're very close to the K variant of the CPUs. Only 5.5% is the 12600K faster. But the more interesting thing is that we are much faster than any of the Ryzen 5000 chips and the 11th gen Intel processors. Bear in mind, even the Apple M1 Max is around 12% slower. In the Cinebench R23 multi-core, you can see that we're trading blows with the Apple M1 Max. We're basically identical there. But the Apple M1 Max has 10 cores, 8 performance cores, 2 efficiency cores. But that over here really shows how good the threads per core are, because our chip is a 6-core, but we have 2 threads per core, which, as you can see, we're keeping up with a 10-core CPUs. More interestingly, we're about 9% faster than the 11600K, which uses much more power to achieve these results, around 125 watts plus pulled from the socket. Never mind the Ryzen 5600X, which is about 15% slower. Moving on to Geekbench 5 for everyday computer tasks, let's see how good are we. In terms of the single core, we're similar to the 11900K, which is 2 or sometimes 3 times the price of this 12400, but we're very close to the 12600K and the Apple M1 Max. The Ryzen 5600X is about 9% slower, and the high Ryzen 9s are a few percent slower. In Geekbench multi-core scores, we are still faster than the 11600K, but now the 11900K obviously goes past us because of the 8 cores and much higher power draw, probably 3-4 times the power draw, depends, you know, how you're gonna run it. But as you can see, we're still beating out our other 6-core CPU competitors, the 11600K and Ryzen 5600X. Moving on to actual real-world application, this is where things get very interesting. In Photoshop, you can see that the 11900K is only 3.9% faster, yet draws much more power and costs much more, which makes this 12400 extremely, extremely appealing. Looking at the Ryzen 5600X, which is a few percent slower, and the 11600K, which is extra few percent slower. But a big note over here is if you're running Ryzen 5000 or 11th gen processors, in fact, anything apart from the 12th gen, I'd still recommend you to go and use Windows 10. I did a recent test here on the 11600K on Windows 10 and Windows 11. The early benchmarks from Windows 10, even older version, which should be running slower, are much faster than the latest Windows 11 benchmarks. As you can see, there's over 10% difference between those two operating systems. Interestingly, we're about 25% faster in Photoshop than the Apple M1 Max. Bear in mind, I wouldn't slay Apple M1 Max completely off here because these are quite early benchmarks that I've seen some of the other reviewers post online, but I expect the real world now, when Photoshop is more optimized, to get a little bit closer to 12400F, yet I still don't think it's quite as good as the 12400F just because of the single core performance. But according to the benchmarks that are out there in the world that we can actually test, we are 25% fast. Now in Lightroom Classic, what gets very interesting is that our 12400F is faster than 11900K, 5600X, 10900K, and 11600K. Some of these chips are 2-3 times its price range, and we're not far off from the 12600K. So there's about 11.5% improvement when moving on to the i5K variant of 12th gen CPUs. Moving on to video editing. In Premiere Pro, we have a standard overall score. And I managed to pull out some of the later benchmarks from the Apple M1 Max. As you can see, it has improved quite a bit because finally the Geekbench can really score the live playback of Apple M1 Max chips, which is very, very impressive. And we're getting close to the 12th gen CPUs. Regardless, that's kind of the only factor that really pushes the overall score very high. If you look at any of the other, like GPU FX score, export score, then they are much lower than the 12th gen chips. But in overall score, the Apple M1 Max is 17.5% faster. Just bear in mind the price point for that M1 Max, that's gonna cost you at least 3.5 grand. In here, the 11900K is 8.6% faster, but still the 12400 is very, very appealing because of the price range. But it gets interesting when we compare it to the Apple M1 Pro with 16-core GPU, and we are roughly about 1% faster. So we're trading blows with the Apple M1 Pro, but at much lower price point. We're faster than the 11600K and the Ryzen 5600X. Bear in mind that for this benchmark, the 5600X didn't have an RTX 3090, but RTX 3070. Even if we add up to 10% for the RTX 3090, we're still much, much slower. In After Effects, I don't have a tons of benchmarks for you because After Effects just changed their benchmarking score, so I have a few over here. We are 11.8% slower than the 12600K, but a few percent better than the 11900K and 11600K. Moving on to DaVinci Resolve. In this application, our 12400 isn't quite as appealing as any of the other ones, but still, we're trading blows with the Ryzen 5600X. Bear in mind that CPU is running an RTX 3070, so very impressive score compared to our 6-core CPU over here. The 11600K is a few percent slower, but the Ryzen 5900X with RTX 3070 is about 6% faster. 11900K with 3090 is 10% faster, and the 12600K is about 14% faster. So for DaVinci Resolve, the 12600K would probably make a better sense than this 12400. But regardless, if you are on a budget, it's still very, very competitive. Moving on to Blender, and we have two benchmarks over here, BMW, which is a shorter render scene, and a Glassroom, which is a longer render scene. Bear in mind, in here, the lower the score is, the better the results, because that's time in seconds it took to render out the scene. Hence, the percentages are the other way around. Our 12400 is faster than the Apple M1 Max and 11600K. In fact, the 11600K is 6% slower. Compared to the Ryzen 5600X, we are 20% faster, which is insane. We're not quite as good as the 11900K, and 12600K, which obviously have more cores in Blender, that means better performance. Moving on to Classroom, which is a longer benchmarking scene, we can see that we are still faster than the 11600K and Apple M1 Max and the Ryzen 5600X. Obviously not as good as the higher core count CPUs like the 11900K, 5900X and 12600K. Before I'm gonna go over to the conclusion, this CPU can actually be overclocked. You might have seen Der Bauer, the German overclocker, showed how this 12400 can sometimes be overclocked past 12900K in gaming benchmarks. But as a creator, I don't think you should be doing overclocking on your CPU, because you're massively gonna sacrifice the stability of the system. And Intel actually says that if the non-K variant CPUs are overclocked, they actually void warranty. In conclusion, this 12400 is a seriously impressive CPU, especially when you look how much the CPU costs. We're beating out the 11600K, which is more expensive and draws much more power, which makes this 12400 extremely, extremely appealing. It also has a great upgrade path. The iGPU is a great help for creators, especially those doing video editing in Premiere Pro and DaVinci Resolve. So as a creator, please do not go with the F variant of this. The only downside I can think about this system is that the motherboard options aren't as varied when it comes to budget motherboards, but you can still find a budget motherboard roughly around $150. But if you're a creator who uses Adobe Creative Cloud, I highly recommend you go check out the Asus ProArt B660 motherboard, which actually gives you 3 months for free Adobe Creative Cloud membership, which makes this B660 motherboard very, very affordable for you. In conclusion, do I recommend this i5-12400? Yes, absolutely. It's absolutely flipping fantastic in this price range. Even if you want to create maybe some small form factor PCs that have no dedicated GPU, but have this iGPU inside, maybe you want this just for like browsing the web or something like that. It's insane. There's nothing like this in there. The multi-core performance is amazing. Cooling it down is no problem. And the single core performance is better than any of the Ryzen 5000 chips and 11th gen processors from Intel, which makes the everyday usage with this CPU very, very fast and snappy. I'll also leave the link for this in the description below if you're interested in picking this up. Thanks guys for watching, likes if you enjoyed it, subs if you'd like to see more, and I'll see you next time. See you soon.